I knew, Sister Ayan told me, Shaila, my Muslim name is Shaila, but I still go by the name Jillian. I knew that the minute I put polygamy, everybody would start, and I saw it, yes. But polygamy for me will be another story for another day, because, mashallah, in one short word or two short words, I love it. And inshallah, I hope that most of my Muslim sisters will come to that level one day and join me in this fantastic, fantastic, fantastic journey that I am on with my polygamous family. However, so today I'm to talk about business. And these two ladies have told me we'll drag you off the stage. So let me get down straight to it. For a Muslim woman to be in business has always been questionable. And you as a Muslim, or me as a Muslim, would say, why? Because we have the most beautiful example. The first lady to take Shahada was our mother, Khadija bint Khuwailid. And when she took Shahada, she was already a businesswoman. And I'm not talking about a businesswoman who was just selling potatoes or vegetables. She had a multinational business. In those days, how do we know this? How do we know this? Because when she got married to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the reason they got together was she had employed our Prophet to do her business for her. So any lady who feels, oh, business is hard, business is this, how do I start, where do I start, all these are questions, correct? How many of us here would like to start business? If you're in business, it's fine. How many of you would like to start? Please put your hand up. There you go. You see, we have over 100 ladies in business today. How many are you already in business? Come on, come on. I know we are there. How many of you would like to grow into your business? Great. Now, I will take you back to our mother, Khadija radhiyallahu anha. What were her traits for her business? And I believe these traits that she had was one of the reasons she was as successful as she was. Who can help me? Who can help me? Who knows what Khadija used to do? Pray, yes, thank you very much. No? Okay, she was very generous. Business is not only to make money. As a Muslim, I am in business, alhamdulillah, for two reasons. One, to push me through this world, and the second is to reach my Creator. Whatever you have, whatever you do in business, it's nothing of you. It is what Allah has written for you. When you get to that concept, Allah has given me 100,000. Today, alhamdulillah, let me give 20,000 here, let me give 20 there. Ansar sisters, yes. So mama, ya mama, yes. That is banking. I don't think I have any of my students here today, but banking starts right when you are in university or in college. Banking for akhirah. And that's the business I want to talk to you about today. When we talk business, we're not just any other person. We are a Muslimah in business. And that takes us 20 steps higher than any of our other other businesses not run by Muslims. Bismillah is what, and I became a Muslim, was the first word I was taught. Bismillah, in the name of Allah. So your business should start with the name of Allah. I do this, Bismillah. Today I'm going to teach this subject. Of course, I was a teacher. Bismillah. I hope my children will benefit. Everything you do, Bismillah, Bismillah, Bismillah. So the first concept for a Muslimah in business, whatever I have is from Allah. Be it good, be it bad. Sometimes you send in for a job, you don't get it. You're like, ah, damn, what did I do wrong? Why didn't I get it? No, it was not written for you. So you say, Alhamdulillah. When it comes to you, Alhamdulillah. Do the job properly. That's the next part I need to speak about. As Muslims, you're not only in business for yourself. You're in business for the Ummah. I will get the tender, yes. But whatever I have said I will do, you must do that. If anything, go 2 steps ahead and give better. Because the barakah you get from that is more than the money value you will get from it. Your Creator is watching you. And believe you me, as I said, I came into business accidentally. But today, I get a call and say, Julian, please come and do this and this for us. Okay, I don't know you. Where are you calling from? Oh, we got your number from so and so. Reason being is, if you say you're going to do it plus 2. Are we together? Okay, so when I talked about, the generosity, loyalty is the next one. If you're starting a business, you have to be still loyal to who? To Allah first. So whatever you're doing in your business, this is identifying your business, how to help you identify your business. It has to be 99.9999999999, there's nothing else, 100% what Allah will be pleased with. Never compromise your business situations for anything. It's not worth it. I'll give you an example. Advertising, that's one of my businesses. In advertising, we have a lot of people who want to advertise. Advertising is building your brand, so that you can get more markets, so you get known, so that you can get more products out, etc., etc. So advertising. Alhamdulillah, we've been in the business, my husband and I, for over 18 years. And at that time, about 12 years ago, I was still teaching, and he called me and he says, okay, honey, I'm going for this contract. One of the salesperson has brought me this contract, and it's a lot of money. So I need to go and collect it cash. So I'll not come and pick you for lunch. I told him, no problem, you go. I have my meeting at Nation Media at 2 o'clock, so we'll meet after that. Alhamdulillah. As he went to meet this big deal, Koroshe Industries says, okay, hold on, is this water or alcohol we are advertising? Before he reached the office, he had already called our competitor and told him, please meet me in so-and-so place. I have a contract for you. The guy was like, what? Yes, contract. 4 million. Put advertising boards, billboards, everything. So the guy asked him, why are you giving me this contract? He says, it's not halal. I cannot do it. In a split of a second, he gave it up. Knowing that this, we were going to advertise for water, not for the alcohol, but the foundation of behind where the water came from was not halal. So I, in those days, we didn't have these gadgets. So he finished. I went to Nation Media. I was sitting in the boardroom and waiting for the contract and me to do my presentation. And Alhamdulillah, after I finished, they gave me the contract. I signed the contract for 8 million, and that was it. What I'm trying to show you today, don't give up on the halal. It can be tempting. Shaitan will come up. He will give you different things in business. It's very difficult. You can say, let me do this shortcut. Allah will forgive me. No, Allah will bless you if you leave that. He will give you something else. That is for sure. Okay? I had a few hands who wanted to start business. Who is stuck on what to do? Do you know what business you want to start? No? Do you want to know how to look for business? Okay. How many of you can cook? How many of you can cook? Okay. Those who can cook, how many of you are married women and are working in offices and have children and waking up to get good meals for them is a problem? I'm one of them. Who needs your children to have good halal food? Yep, there you go. So you see, there's already a demand for your expertise in cooking, right? So the one who needs the halal food and the one who needs her children to get good food, right? So how do you start about it? You don't need big capital. Today we had our sister Batuli who told us about social media. Do a few dishes, put them up. Go to the schools around you. Go anywhere. Go, talk to your neighbors. Your neighbor, she must be a working woman. Search. But there's so many of these halal jobs that you can do. Halal takeout is one. Tutoring. Do you remember when Aisha started with us this morning and told us about covering our heads and not our brains, correct? Many of our sisters, we have finished college, we have finished school, we finished university. We are at home maybe looking after the kids, but we can still tutor. Tutoring is one of the businesses that is really flying today, and even the online courses. For you to start your business, you have to know what you want. It should be a passion, because if you start a business and you have no interest, or you just started because my neighbor started it, it won't work, my dear sister. It won't work. You must understand what you want from that business. You must understand, do I like this? Do I like cooking? Or am I cooking just because I have to give those kids food? If you have a passion for your job, if you have a passion for that business, it will succeed. Another mistake that a lot of the business world does, or anyone who wants to go into business, is, fulani, alianza hiyo kazi ya kujenga nyumba. Wacha mimi nijenge pia. That guy most probably has a family or somebody, he's done his research, he knows how to construct houses. Sorry about that. He has done his homework. But you, because, you know, you saw him driving a little Toyota, and now on an Indesha Mark X, you say, he's successful, so I can do it. No, it'll not work like that. You need to do your ground research on any business. Is it something you can handle? For the simple reason, in the business world, if it's your business, you need to know how to work it. You might get some good employees, you might not get good employees. I've been down that line. You say, okay, teach everybody everything, and then you walk out? No. Your business is your business. If you can't handle it, nobody else will do it for you. No one else will do it for you. So, another small story here. My co-wife, she wanted to start, well, now this is the third one she's starting, alhamdulillah. Allah make it easy for her. Her first business she started was, she was pushed into it, unfortunately. My husband pushed her into doing animal feed. No head, no tail, long story, big investment, down the drain. The second one she did was bread making. Bread making was not really her fault per se, But COVID came, so she could not handle the COVID, and that was the end of the story. The light under the tunnel is she has tried. She has tried once, twice, thrice. Now she's doing pizzas. She used to make amazing pizzas at home. So we told her, okay, try it. And she started doing pizzas. What has helped her is building the brand. In business, you must build your brand. This is marketing strategies. And it's simple things. Batuli told us about social media, easiest way. Every time she has an offer, I post it for her, the whole family, you see, extended family, polygamous family. So in one shot, we have more than 50 advertisements out that there's a, sorry about that, there's a special offer on pizzas. So building your brand is the next one. How do you build a brand? You need to identify your market. You need to identify these pizzas, who are they going to? This food that I'm cooking at home, who is it going to? Yeah? Social media, easiest, fastest, and cheapest way to get your product out there. I'm going back to those sisters who had put up their hand to start businesses. There are a few businesses that till today, are running and are multi-million businesses. Does anyone know how Coca-Cola started? Yes, absolutely right. When they started, they were three college boys trying to make a drink, and they decided to put some gas in it, tried it, and said, okay, it's good. And they only sold 15 bottles in the first year. That was when they officially started. Before that, it was 7 bottles, and that's it. KFC. Kentucky Fried Chicken. Started how? Anyone, any idea? It started the same way in an old lady's kitchen. Her husband was a colonel, and he found her chicken boring, so he took it and wrapped it in bread and put it in the oven. It was not the fry that we know originally. And that's how KFC started. We have our own local one here, Tropical Heat. How many of you know Tropical Heat? They do spices, they do snacks, they do all kinds of things. Tropical Heat was started 50 years ago, just by an old lady making chevra and crisps and her spices. She started packing them and, you know, sending them over to the UK. Till today, I think some of us still do that. You know, our relatives call, if anyone's coming, they don't want chocolates from Kenya. They want the tea and they want the spices. So Tropical Heat was the same story. It started in Parklands, on First Parklands 50 years ago, just by selling and making at home. Today, Tropical Heat is in over 15 countries worldwide. So it's how big you dream, how big you work, and how to start. Okay, we were at Halal Takeouts, tutoring, editing, and proofreading. This has become a massive industry today. We have no time to take editors. Why do I like proofreading and editing for our Muslimas? It's simple. You're at home, you've got your little baby, you do a sheet or two sheets today, tomorrow you do it again, and you get paid. And by the way, proofreading goes up to 600 bob a page today. So that's something you can look into. Halal child care. That has become a big market here in Kenya.
Halal child care is very important. For us nice and matured ones, we didn't have this offer for the children when I had my small kids. So you can't take your child to child care and you don't know what they're giving you. So this is an open market that has become really high in demand. I know in Parklands we already have about 6 where the kids are taken to the house, a small apartment. You can be registered. I'll talk about registration in the next few. And you look after your child. I know I can go about my business with no problem as long as I know my child is safe. But if the child care is calling me, Mama, mtoto amenyongeka, Mama, high fever, you know, then you can't concentrate on your business, correct? So that's another business that's really lucrative at the moment. Blogging, fashion and design. Now, fashion and design, yes, Islamic fashion and design. There are a few sisters that if you look on the internet, businesses, big businesses. There's one called the Hijabi. Who's heard about the Hijabi? She's a Muslim sister, Muslima, who started in Canada, is now a multi-million business. And all she did was she got the need of wearing hijab. She, as a Muslima, had problems because she had to wear her hijab. So it became a fashion statement. She started by giving her colleagues, the non-Muslims, scarves and saying, okay, see what you can do with it. They put it on and they're like, wow, that is interesting. And that's how that lady's business started. She started just by encouraging others to accept the hijab. And today it's online as well. It's an online business and it's doing extremely well. So again, back to identifying what you want to do in the business, you must have the passion for it. I'll repeat again. If you have the passion for it, it will work out. The legal implications to starting your business. You know, I think the biggest is always capital. And I believe we count our feet when we start looking like, okay, where am I going to get this capital? How am I going to do it? No, I have to register. Yes, you need to do all that. But you don't have to do it all at once. For a single business permit, all you need is your identification, your PIN number, and that is it. You can register a single business, and that is about 1,500 shillings. And you can do all the small businesses I was talking about as a legal business, okay? When it comes to the legality of businesses, once you do a fully fledged business, you start up small, you're given 3 years to start up small as a single business, and then you need to register it completely. So you've got 3 years to grow. Once you've grown the 3 years, you do a full registration where you get your PIN certificate for the company and you start the business. You also have to register for the normal things that are KRA. You have to get a county license. You have to get a PIN for the company as well. Islam teaches us one thing. Whenever you have an agreement, have it on paper. Yeah? This is the same thing. When you have your company registered, keep everything straight. Have your VAT, because our very nice friends from KRA, when they come and they see you're organized and you have everything with you, believe you me, they will not disturb you. So keep everything straight from day one. If you're selling a product, always put that VAT on that product. Keep the VAT money separately. Use whatever you've used for production. Profit. Only use your profit and you will grow. If you are strict and self-disciplined is very important for us Muslimas because we have a problem. and I've been through it. I'll make something, sell it, and if I've made something and I've sold it for 1500, I used to go and spend my 1500. So that's where I went wrong, and I learned the hard way. You can't spend the 1500. The 1500 was most probably part of the taxes first, part of production, and part of investment. So those are the three things that you need to keep aside. You have to pay the VAT because they'll come for you. You have to have enough for your next production, and you have to have to return your capital so that by the end of the year, your business is rotating. Yeah? So those are a few of the points. Legal matters, marketing we've covered, business, identifying the business is the biggest one. So I think I've covered everything, and Aisha doesn't want to come and pull me down with my feet. So I think I'll wrap up here for now. But that's all the basis that we need for business. Again, how many ladies can cook? How many ladies can cook? Fantastic. How many ladies need good fresh food once in a while in your house or for your kids every day in school? I need it. Come and look for me and I'll order some food from you. Thank you so much, my dear sisters. It was a great pleasure. Thank you to Ayan and your team for inviting me. I'm honored. Have a good day.